I would never in a million years have predicted this on a most gifted list.
I'm
never.
A, I'm 40.
Oh, that's nice.
Welcome to the Whisky Tribe.
Hi.
It's gonna be the most gifted whiskeys relevant to the season. And
that's right.
We convinced somebody to share their insider data with us. That's how we got the list. Here we go. So, Reserve Bar. Mm-hmm. This is like online ordering of like spirits and whatnot shipped directly to your door. Now, most of these companies, be it brick and mortar, be it online, they're very, very protective of the data.
Yes, they are.
They don't want to share. So this list, the most gifted whiskeys, because people can select if it's a gift or not.
And then put a little
gift. Yes, okay. The most gifted whiskeys that are going through
right.
their website there. The one exception was they say, okay, guys, we'll share the data, but it has to be in no particular order.
Oh, okay. So not like most sold. Least sold, you're just random.
Yeah, so
that's good because I wanted to arrange them in the order of a good tasting.
Okay.
But so we don't blow out our palate early on.
Let's do that. And then also, these whiskeys that people are actively gifting to their friends and family.
Right.
Let's, based on that whiskey, let's see, well, if you like this, you probably would like this other whiskey as an alternative, maybe.
Yeah, probably. So, okay. Suggested things?
Yeah, so if you like this, then a good alternative that's similar could be this other thing.
That's entirely based on our experience of trying things.
Right. Subjective based on our preferences there.
Okay, we're gonna go straight from this directly to Gentleman Jack.
Okay. How many of these whiskeys do you think are gonna be in like the 40% ABV, between 40 and 50?
I mean, all.
I'm thinking so.
All.
I'm thinking so. And I'm not really butthurt about that because this is a gifted list. Oh, peanut butter on the nose. You get like peanut butter, peanut brittle.
Oh, yeah.
A peanut brittle.
Yeah.
So again, more wood character than you typically get out of the traditional.
Yeah, but this is a little less aggressive on the deep sugars.
Yeah.
And just a little softer around the edges.
Well, you know what? I was finding more oakiness on the nose than I did on the taste.
Yeah, the taste is a lot softer.
Right. So here's my theory.
40% alcohol.
Here's my theory. One of the hardest things to do whenever you're deep into any kind of hobby is give a gift to somebody that you want to ensure that they're going to enjoy.
Yeah, I'm bad at that.
That's not necessarily something that you think is cool.
Freud.
The deeper you are into a thing, anything, any hobby, any type of research, and the more familiar and the more knowledge and understanding you have, the harder it is for you to relate to anybody that doesn't know that.
Hard to imagine not knowing what you know and not assuming that that's ground level for everyone else.
So this is what I'm most eager about with this most gifted whiskeys list. Because by being able to look at the data of what's actually being gifted,
right,
it's gonna be helpful for you to figure out not necessarily what you would like to receive as a whiskey lover, but what you think people would like to receive based on where they are at. What would have been a good alternative if somebody's in Gentleman Jack territory?
Maybe Dickel, like a really mild Dickel, even though it's not Jack Daniel's, the other Tennessee whiskey,
what you
know?
Do. This is what you buy. The regular Jack Daniels,
mm-hmm.
and you pour some water in there.
Done. Or just filter it through one of those like Brita filters.
That, like, it's so janky. It does make
the single biggest consumer of Brita filters in the world. Jack Daniels and Dickel.
No, but it's activated charcoal, and they're sending it through there, and it does take some of the edges off.
All right, Crown Royal Black.
Okay, now this is the black.
The black, which is
different.
More of charred oak.
Okay.
And blended at a higher proof.
Right.
And so they're trying to say it's 45% alcohol, 90 proof. They're trying to say this is what Crown Royal tastes like with a little more char and a little more proof.
So on the nose, there is a little bit more barrel than what I typically get from a Crown Royal. That is just a very classic, middle of the road, like a budget Canadian palate of the almost like an artificial vanilla, a little metallic. Super sweet, super easy going there.
Strangely, right out of the gates, I would almost have picked this as a really low proof bourbon before I would have picked it as a Canadian whiskey.
Because of the barrel note.
Yeah.
Crown Royal isn't necessarily our jam, right? But credit where credit's due, it did add more wood character to this, and they didn't just, let's put black on there. Black is sexy, right?
The vanilla is so strong with this one, right? The vanilla is strong with this one. But there is this sort of tannic barrel note that's a lot more dominant than any Crown Royal I've ever had before. So this is the triple distilled, twice charred Irish whiskey Jameson black barrel. Now remember who's probably working or contributing to working on these. Gare, our friend Gare.
Oh.
Because this is them taking bourbon barrels,
yeah,
into the cooperage,
yeah,
and then charring them again.
Yeah, yeah.
So used bourbon barrels, right, charring them again, then putting their whiskey in it.
So you saw he's referring to over at Jameson with Gear Buckley, mm-hmm, the fifth generation master cooper.
Yeah.
Hell of a guy. We like that guy a lot.
A little extra woody note in the Jameson.
See, I don't find extra wood.
I find a little bit of a dryness that I'm attributing to wood.
Okay, so I do find a little bit of like that buttery vanilla,
mm-hmm,
but it's not quite as sweet and rich as, right, I typically remember.
Less sugar.
It's a little less sugar.
I would say this is to Jameson what Crown Royal Black is to Crown Royal. You know what I mean? A slight variant in an interesting direction, but still the... so wrong. For this slightly tannic Jameson, what else would you recommend?
How would you like a Powers?
Yeah, but like a Powers malt. Like, take them into malt, because if they can handle that not overly sweet note of Jameson, mm-hmm, they might be ready for Irish pot still.
Well, of this particular Jameson.
Yeah.
Yep.
If they like this, mm-hmm, then they might be ready for Irish pot still. I'm about to pour you a rye that's not your typical rye. It's interesting to me that this shows up on a Most Gifted list. I would never in a million years have predicted this on a Most Gifted list. Never.
I'm excited. And specifically, again, let's reiterate, these are whiskeys because there's an option. You can choose as send as a gift.
Right. Now, Woodford Reserve, I would buy that. I would buy it,
right,
as a Most Gifted.
Right.
But the Woodford Reserve rye...
That is interesting. And... Well, oh, let's get in here.
Ooh, that's, it's those, what do you call it? Candy cane that's not red and white, but it's got like a cherry candy cane.
Oh, okay. And I'm getting like a really rich botanical.
Yeah, then all the herbs.
That rye botanical herby quality.
Oh, it's the same in the palate. That is the most even transition from nose to palate that I've had in ages.
Yeah.
It's very Christmassy. I wonder if that's why it's gifted.
And what eventually it lands on is the taste is exactly what you expect.
Yeah.
The finish though, I don't know, I like it. It's like a cherry caramel finish.
You know what I would do?
I like that rye.
I would do
Michter's
rye.
We did a list with the rye on it, y'all.
Mm-hmm.
Finally happened.
I would do Michter's rye, I think, with this.
Some
not any of your classic typical like Bullet or your Overholt or anything, right, like that. Mm-hmm. I would go Michter's rye. So if you go to the store, there's two Macallan 15s. There's the triple cask 15 and there's the double cask 15.
Now the one that was most gifted.
Double cask.
Double cask.
Yeah.
Okay. And this is the double cask?
Yeah, this is the double cask, right? So remember, this is only bourbon and sherry.
Oh, they mean the barrels?
Yeah.
Yeah. 43% ABV.
Whoa! I was leaning heavy towards the sherry.
I'm getting the butterscotch.
Yeah.
Huge butterscotch.
But and I got a funky note.
You get the funky note. The butterscotch is the main thing. And then right behind that butterscotch, those dark fruits.
My biggest problem with Macallan that I have is I always fall in love with the nose and then the palate doesn't deliver. Always. Every Macallan I've ever had, the nose is one is beautiful, hauntingly beautiful, and then I drink it and think, son of a bitch.
So, the taste, I was gonna say, is way softer than the nose.
Oh man, see, there it is! So one of our friends in the distilling industry was saying a lot of, especially in Scotland, a lot of people, blenders, prioritize nose or palate, one or the other.
Yeah.
And so they go for palate, and then, or nose, and then the palate is an afterthought. Not an afterthought, but it's secondary.
Right.
Or the other way around, they go for palate, and the nose is,
For people judging this on a scale of, you know, smooth to, ow, that hurts.
Yes, yeah, this is drinkable with a little bit of pepper.
So whenever, like, I have friends saying, hey, anyone to get, this is my boss's birthday, I'm gonna get him a whiskey gift or something. And my first question is he a whiskey nerd?
Right.
Yes. And if he is, then that's, you know, there's a bunch of different ways. If he's not, they just like the idea of giving a whiskey, then, you know, it's gonna
Macallan,
be like a Macallan,
yeah.
It's gonna be something classic. Do you at least know if he's bourbon or scotch or
that
Irish?
That helps.
Yeah, and then it's gonna be just a recognizable brand. Maybe something with an extra age statement to make it feel that much fancier.
Buying gifts for bosses, that's a loaded one, man.
What are you gonna get me?
This is the one I'm personally excited about.
Okay.
And it's primarily because I have no memory of what this tastes like.
Okay.
And I like Glenlivet.
Now, I'm quite familiar with the Glenlivet, but...
Yeah, the classic 12.
But not the 18.
Not the 18.
This is Glenlivet 18.
And this made it on Most Gifted. You
it
think
did.
It's just because it's a reasonable price for the age statement?
Well, I was about to say, if you're trying to impress somebody with an age statement, that's a nice age statement right there. 18 years old, that's one to sneeze at. Oh, some maltiness.
Yeah, that like malt must and the orange citrus.
And then there's like a floral honey behind that.
Yes. Oh, wow, that's mild. Is it just me or did that go down like nothing?
It's gotta be down like a 40.
That was even less of a palate impact than Macallan.
40% ABV?
Yeah.
We're giving gifts here. Like I'm thinking, who would I give a gift? I would give a gift to my cousin. My cousin's right out here.
My God, and he would drink that and be like, that's the smoothest thing I've ever had in my life.
Right, every time I give a non-whiskey drinker a Mile High Cask Strength Proof,
right.
I feel like I have to explain a lot.
Right, like, oh, it's fine, so you're gonna get this.
Right.
This, no explanation needed.
Exactly.
But yeah, I think just a classic malt. Honestly, I would recommend the Glenlivet 12 over this.
Glenlivet was actually one of the very, very, very first gifts I ever got getting into whiskey. It was the 12.
Yeah. I would prefer the 12 to this.
Okay.
Both had a little more character. Lagavulin 16 makes the next one. And Lagavulin 16, this is a whiskey gift. This makes sense to me.
Yeah.
Because this is something you're going to give to your family that you know drinks scotch.
Well, right? Specifically, they probably need to be into Islay scotch.
Yeah.
But nobody drinking Islay scotch, right? Honestly, like, the vast majority of people drinking Islay scotch right. is not going to turn their nose up.
No. Even if they prefer Laphroaig or they like Ardbeg right. or something, if you buy them Lagavulin 16, they're going to be fine.
And very often showing up at the top of just classic Islay whiskey lists and preferences.
If you're gonna recommend this one, what else would you get that's not the price, not the price point of Lagavulin 16?
Right.
You know, cause you're talking 100 plus, right?
If you're liking it, it's probably like a Laphroaig 10.
Really? You're gonna go straight from this to Laphroaig 10?
Yeah. For the price.
Wow.
For the price.
I don't know that I would have gone Islay. Maybe Coolula 12.
Really?
Just because Laphroaig 10 is so much more briny, so much more aggressive.
I think there is a tipping point of if you can handle a certain threshold of peatiness, if you can handle that and you're into it, then it's not a stone's throw away from like a Laphroaig 10. It's a little further,
yes. I get that.
I think the biggest barrier to entry is, are you even open to peaty smokiness at all?
I agree. There's three that I want to do together.
Okay. It's the Trilogy one I saw on the list.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There's a Trilogy.
Bob Dylan made all of these himself by hand.
Uh-huh.
It also bottled every bottle.
He plays your favorite Bob Dylan song while he pours the whiskey over it, over the fingers playing the song,
right.
And then they capture and they bottle it.
Everybody knows that.
Who's actually really involved in the whiskey, though? We know the people that were working with him.
Now, the really actually—
It wasn't as involved as what we're saying.
No. What Bob Dylan actually does is one of his hobbies is welding and like creating art by welding things and chopping metal.
Yeah.
This is part of the gate in front of his property.
Yep.
A little bit musty, a little bit coconut, a little bit dark cherry.
Just a tiny bit of granola.
A little bit wood.
Right now.
Oops!
Oh no.
How did that happen?
Shall I do?
How could that possibly have happened? Oh,
right?
Perfumey.
Yeah.
And butterscotch and
wow.
Toffee.
Yeah.
Toffee. You know what this is? This is almond roca.
Oh.
Nuts and toffee and chocolate.
Real quick, what were we just doing? Explain this to people, putting it on your hands.
Yeah, so when you pour alcohol or a whiskey that has the oils, so it's got things that interact with barrels or pot still or not, and then you evaporate, what you're doing is evaporating all the alcohol and leaving behind all the residual oils on your hands.
Yep, and those take center stage.
Mm.
Creaminess.
That's great, there's a vibrance to that. Now the rye comes from what's referred to in the industry as cigar barrels.
It has nothing to do with cigars.
No.
It has to do with
it's a shape. As a matter of fact, I think those Laphroaig barrels in our distillery are technically in the category of cigar barrels.
And this is like a fresh.
That is floral herbal.
Yeah.
That
big,
is
big bright flavor.
Tea shop. When you're trying all the raw teas and doing blends and things. Oh. Ooh. That's nice.
It's like an herbal tea.
Yeah, with a little honey.
Yep, honey in there.
Almost a little bit of like when you heat up tea and you put a little lemon squeeze into it because you got the cold or something like that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But there are also some shared elements with the Tennessee we just get.
Yeah.
We just did. At that lower proof, there's a lot of nice stuff dancing around in that glass.
So, Rex.
You think about what you did.
Somehow I grabbed two bottles of the Tennessee bourbon instead of the blue labeled double barrel bourbon.
Can we order that on reserve bar?
Yeah, I'm hoping.
Blue. No, there it is.
There it is.
Double barrel. So we'll just order that on reserve bar.
Is this the... This is on the list. This is Johnnie Walker Blue. Which totally makes sense.
Yes.
Because this is one of those I want to impress you and spend a little money on you gifts.
I think if there were a whiskey that was designed to be a gift, just to recognizable label, It feels like it's special. You got the color of
They know you've spent money.
They know you've spent money, yeah.
It's approachable and drinkable, right, even for a slightly smoky.
Yeah, you want to get credit for the spend.
Yep. This meets every possible list of giftable for every reason.
This is more lively and interesting than I remember. How is that only 40%?
Okay, so look.
That's a beautiful nose.
It's a beautiful nose.
It's a big, rich, lively nose.
It's actually not bad on the palate.
And it delivers not fully what you were hoping for from the nose, but enough to make you go, oh, that's pretty
way
nice.
More than the Macallan did.
Okay, what else?
That's the last of them until we get to the things you ordered.
Wow, let's go, let's do that thing.
All right, Daniel, so we waited a few moments. I think it was less than a week for us to get the deliveries in from the reserve bar because yes. You didn't grab.
We had Ryan Tennessee bourbon, but we didn't have the double
barrel bourbon. So pour that. I shouldn't say this,
okay,
but probably would have done an episode without the sponsorship because the nature of what Reserve Bar is.
Yeah.
It's the shipping of freaking whiskey.
Yeah, which is like the number one thing floating in our brains right now.
It's the holy grail of freaking whiskey. So I had conversations with these guys because you and I have looked at this several different ways. The entire country, if you live in the States, getting whiskey shipped to your house, it's a big hot mess.
It's a mishmash of states' rights.
Yes. And there's a handful of other like websites and services that can get stuff to your house, but it's always with like weird asterisks. Like you have to be within a couple mile radius of a liquor store.
Right.
And then it has to be the selection at that liquor store, and then somebody will run it out to you. It's like, this is, if you live in one of the few dozen states that they ship to,
right,
if you have a zip code in the state, they can get it to your door. So I went into the website. I went to Reserve Bar. I put in orders. First thing, I owe you a wild turkey.
Oh, yeah, that's right, because...
But it's my birthday, so this is mine.
Wait, that you can't ungift a gift.
So the wild turkey, it would arrive in a few days. Beautiful, landed, perfect, great. Is this boring you? Is this game-changing freaking service of not any value or interest to you?
You took away the wild turkey.
Son of a bitch. Why?
Okay, so tell me about the shipping.
Now I don't want to. The next thing I put in for Knob Creek.
Oh, yeah.
Perfect.
Got it.
A few days later. Another thing we didn't get to that was actually on the top gifted list.
Right.
The Uncle Nearest.
Oh,
the
1856. Yeah, it's just a classic damn good bourbon.
And I get like a peanut in there, man.
Yeah.
It's like a nice peanut.
Yes, absolutely. That's sort of dusty.
The Reserve Bar, it was originally created because some buddies wanted an easier way to gift spirits and things.
Oh, nice.
So they also sent us a Johnnie Walker Blue. And it's another very highly gifted whiskey on the list. And they sent it with an example of the engraving. You can get these things engraved as gifts and whatnot. And for this, the very first time we've ever been able to do this, in the description of this episode, all of the whiskeys that were on the most gifted whiskeys list,
right,
there are going to be links in the descriptions for you to be able to click on any of these whiskeys, go to Reserve Bar, and in most states, they can ship you whiskey.
Oh, nice.
And then you can see right on individual bottle pages which states you can get stuff to. So I'm going to be using the hell out of this.
Yeah.
I'm, you know, cool that they sponsored it, but shit, man, I'd be super excited about this without any kind of sponsorship. Oh, and then the other thing is, so they sponsored the episode.
Right.
But I did not clear with them what I was going to do as my birthday shenanigan. It's just a light indemnification, nothing too serious. They didn't sign off on what's about to happen. Here we go.
Daniel, it's a very special day.
Is it?
It's my 40th birthday.
Oh, you're over the hill now.
Yep. But the most important thing is there's an official rule in the whiskey tribe that on your 40th birthday, you get whatever you want.
Wait, I had...
With no restrictions whatsoever.
I had my 40th birthday 2 years ago.
You should have read the bylaws. And because I'm now old and feeble,
right,
I gotta overcompensate a little bit.
Ah.
We filled a truck full of whiskey, and you're gonna drive me around.
Oh, man. Oh.
I'm going to need to have a personal flotation device.
Oh, yeah.
If you can.
Is this like a bubble boy thing?
You feel dirty?
Hey, no eye contact. Don't look at me. Wow.
Do you have a helmet? You look like... What's the girl in Willy Wonka's chocolate factory turns into a blueberry?
Still got it.
You got it?
Have you been practicing my song, Dan?
My whole life, I've been practicing for this moment. I shall perform Happy Birthday. I don't know if you've ever heard this or not. Concerto from, when did this come out? 1745?
For the record, neither one of them have been drinking at all.
That's true.
I'm 40.
How'd you run?
The whiskey's a lot cloudier than it was.
Did you crap your pants?
I don't know, I could have two birthday wishes come true.
It's Daniel in shorts.
These are my swim shorts.
Damn, boy.
Keep it tight. I think I got a felon. Yep. I got it.
This is the song of my people.
Everybody's out of the way.